Hi, everybody. Today's topics are going to fall under the heading of biotechnology. Now, we're not going to be able to explore the whole world of biotechnology because it's so wide and so detailed, but we will take a look at some of the common inner workings of biotechnology. So I guess the first question to be answered, what is it? Well, if you look down below here, you can see it's applying biological principles to develop and enhance products, tools, and technological advances in fields such as agriculture, food science, and medicine. So all in all, biotechnology is working for us to make our lives better. So biologists that work in this field are doing experiments every day to enhance human lives. As we begin to explore biotechnology, one of the first things that always pops into people's heads, the idea of cloning. And most of the time it's, you know, should we clone humans kind of thing. But cloning is more than that. It's the production of identical copies of DNA, cells, or organisms. So our Time magazine cover that you see over there, that is representing Dolly the sheep, which was the first mainstream animal to be cloned that brought the idea of cloning to the forefront of the world's people. They saw that you could do it with a mammal such as a sheep, and they started thinking, wow, what if humans could be cloned? Now, we're not going to get into a highly contentious debate today about whether or not that should occur, but you know, if you go ahead and you Google, should humans be cloned, you're going to find a lot of different opinions, and you're going to find a lot of the current rules globally that exist to cover human cloning. So I'll let you do the exploration there. We'll just stick to the science today. Now, if we think about cloning a little bit further, just think of bacteria for a second. If you look over here in this test tube, you can see there's a few bacteria swimming around in there. And what we could say is that if you started with one, and whatever this fluid is, let's imagine it was a nutrient for those bacteria, eventually that one is going to grow and develop until it reaches a certain size, and then it's going to reproduce itself through binary fission. So essentially, what's going to happen is that if given enough time and enough food, what you'll see is essentially a colony of clones, a colony of bacteria that are identical genetically. Now, we could even come further out from bacteria and get into bigger organisms such as ourselves. And if we want to take a look at how it can happen in humans without any tinkering by scientists, we look no further than identical twins. Because once an egg is fertilized and the cells start dividing through mitosis, they're essentially producing the same cell a number of times. And every once in a great while, what we'll see is the ball of cells that's reproducing will cleave off a few cells, which then start developing on their own. So we have a second organism that's also going to be going through the mitosis process, building a new ball of cells, and both of them wind up implanting in the uterine wall. So in that case, identical twins are even clones. However, through their lifetime, we do see some subtle changes. The twins experience different things, and this is for probably another talk when we bring in epigenetics and a whole host of other topics like that. But essentially, you know, we can look at the fingerprints of identical twins. We'd expect them to be identical, and we find that they're not. They're entirely different from their identical twins' fingerprints. So there are some subtle differences that we do see in identical twins. However, they do have the same DNA genome to one another. So how did the idea of cloning get in the collective minds of people all over the globe? Well, like we said a minute ago, it happened through the cloning of a sheep producing an offspring named Dolly. So let's look at the steps that happened for that to occur. First, some mammary cells were removed from a 6-year-old ewe in its last trimester of pregnancy. Those cells were then placed on culture dishes, and they were starved of nutrients to a point almost near death, as you can see here, and they're symbolized by these green cells. Now, the next thing that happened was that an unfertilized sheep egg was enucleated. So what that means is that all of its genetic content was taken out, and it was replaced by the nuclear contents of those cells near death. So the cell near death, we allowed it to really pass on its DNA to this egg that had lost its DNA. So we essentially replaced the nucleus. Now, the egg is going to respond as if it's fertilized. And at that point, it's going to start going through mitosis and eventually become a morula and then a blastula and all the other stages of embryogenesis. And essentially, what we can have happen, if all the nutrients are there and all the conditions are right, we can go ahead and we can implant this growing mass of cells into a ewe that's ready for pregnancy. And through a number of tries that it took to occur, you can see down here, 277 tries, eventually this growing mass of cells was able to stick, it was able to implant in the uterus and be born from another sheep. So essentially, we had two sheep with identical DNA that existed. So we essentially had a clone of another sheep, which we then called Dolly. Let's go ahead and scale this back. And instead of talking about an entire organism that's cloned, let's just get on a simple level and start talking about genes that are able to be cloned. So gene cloning is the production of many identical copies of the same gene. We have to start somewhere, so this is probably the best place for us to begin. Now, if this inserted gene that we clone is replicated and expressed using cellular machinery, we can recover one of two things. We can recover the clone gene itself or the protein products that it makes. So let's take a look and see how this is done. So in step one, the gene of interest is going to be inserted into the plasmid. So let's take a look and see what we have here. This right here, this little black segment, that is our gene of interest. And what's going to happen is we are going to insert it into a plasmid. Now, what's a plasmid again? Well, if you remember bacteria, we say they have ring-like DNA, which we can see here. But they also have some DNA that's not quite part of their genome. And that is what we call a plasmid. And a plasmid is just a round circle of DNA that may have originated in this bacteria, but most likely not. Bacteria have a slick way of passing on little tiny rings of information, little secret that they can pass through what's called a sex pilus to any other bacteria. And because the cellular machinery of bacteria expresses all the DNA that comes inside of it, whatever's basically printed on that plasmid is going to be expressed by that bacterium. So we have this little extra ring of DNA, which we are now going to insert the gene of interest into that ring of DNA. That's step one. Step two, by the way, before we get to step two, now that it has the little gene of interest in it, we now call it a recombinant DNA plasmid. All right, step two, we're going to go ahead and put that plasmid into the bacterial cell. How do you do that? Well, we can basically treat bacteria samples with certain chemicals and certain temperatures, which allows them to be more permeable to taking up absorbing extracellular DNA, and that's what we're going to do. Once that DNA is inside the bacteria, we're going to call it a recombinant bacterium, which now contains a recombinant plasmid. Next, we can then grow our recombinant bacteria in culture to form a clone of cells containing the cloned gene of interest. So right here, just for simplicity's sake, we'll just have a few of them, 1, 2, 3, and 4. But if you look inside of these recombinant bacteria, what you see now is something we didn't see before, which is these little purple circles. And these are the protein products that that black gene of interest has produced for us. So what do you do now? What's this good for? Well, basically, we can now start researching. We can do some basic research on the gene itself here, or we could possibly go ahead and research the protein, which we'll get to in a minute. But biotechnology is into applying what we know to help with certain global problems. So if we take a look at the two pictures down below, for example, this one, let's say our crops are having a hard time with the pest because we have a whole bunch of possibly invasive species that have come to our area. Now they're, you know, decimating our crops. So what we can do is we can insert a gene into those crops, which can then deter insects from using those as a viable food source. We can also retool bacteria. If we have a gene that allows that to change the diet of bacteria, we can then use them for something useful globally, such as cleaning up oil spills. So bacteria can basically be reprogrammed in order to do the things we want it to do. On the other side, we see the proteins, and we can do some basic research on the protein itself. What amino acids is it made? Is it made of? Can it be applied to other species besides humans to help them as well? And down below, we see a couple of examples where these proteins, through application, allows us to do certain things with them. There's a chemical called TPA, which it's a protein that dissolves blood clots when we are doing heart attack therapy. Another one here we can see on the bottom right, human growth hormone can be grown in these huge bioreactors full of bacteria, where the bacteria have been reprogrammed to produce GH, so people who lack the ordinary amount of growth hormone can then go through therapy with growth hormone that was produced essentially by reprogramming bacteria to do so. Okay, so in our last scenario, we said that basically we have some gene of interest, we put it inside of a bacteria, and now we have a recombinant bacterium. But let's slow down for a second. How do you get a gene of interest into a cell? Well, the key here is by use of what we call restriction enzymes. Restriction enzymes are proteins that cut DNA at specific points. So in other words, they're kind of like chemical scissors. For example, there is one of these restriction enzymes, and its name is ECOR1. And ECOR1 has a very specific set of nitrogenous bases and nucleotides that it's looking for. And it goes like this. It's looking for a sequence that goes GAATTC. Now, because that's on one side of the DNA, the other side of the DNA is also going to be cut. And that would be like this by rules of complementary base pairing. GAA, I'm going backwards now, TTC. Well, hey, wait a second. That's the same sequence going backwards. That's exactly right. And this is what's called a palindromic sequence, which goes the same forwards and backwards. And that's what these restriction enzymes are built to go and attack, those sequences that are palindromic, and they're going to find them on both sides of the DNA. So if we take a look down below, we see the DNA here, and we see that a restriction enzyme is going to do its chemical cutting, since it is a chemical scissor. And where it's going to cut, and I'll just draw a little line here, is right here all the way across and then down. And if we look down here, we see what's now remaining, what's resulting from that cut. It's no longer the perfect double helix in this area here or this area here. Now instead, it's a little bit jagged on the ends. So what happens is these restriction enzymes, they cleave our vector and foreign DNA. So a vector is what is going to carry our new genetic information. And in this case, it's the plasmid. The foreign or human DNA was basically containing our gene of interest. But we're going to hit them both with those restriction enzymes. And here's why. Because when we cut both of them with the same restriction enzyme, what we're going to get are these sticky ends that we were talking about down here. So this is no longer perfect double-strand DNA. Instead, this fragment here and that fragment there have exposed AATT regions. So if this is our plasmid DNA, and we also do the same thing to the human DNA, they're going to fit together very nicely when we combine the two. So that is what restriction enzymes do. They basically make cuts like chemical scissors, and they do that to allow for insertion of foreign DNA into our vector DNA. Another key player that we need on our team here is DNA ligase. And we saw DNA ligase when we were talking about DNA replication in the cell during the S phase of the cell cycle. So do you remember what it did? Hopefully you do, because if you remember the DNA replication process, we said that one strand of DNA, after it separates, gets copied continuously as it moves towards the replication fork. The other piece, however, goes and it basically copies the DNA in the opposite direction, so it does so by way of fragments. We call those Okazaki fragments. And what essentially had to happen were that those fragments had to be connected, and that was the job of DNA ligase. Its job was to seal up those pieces and make it one continuous piece of DNA. So for our need here, we're going to need our gene of interest sealed into the vector DNA again, which is the plasmid DNA. So right here, we can imagine that if DNA ligase was sitting over these two strands with their sticky ends, when it's finished, it should look like that. Our product should be all sealed up nice and neat with its complements intact. And when this happens, we're going to then, as a completed product, called it a splice. A splice has been put into our DNA, and we just call that the general term DNA splicing. Now, the cell membranes of bacteria can be made more permeable, which I mentioned a little bit earlier, to take up plasmids. So we add certain chemicals to it, we change the temperature a little bit, and what we find is that we can get this new spliced DNA into the bacterium that we want to reproduce. So both bacteria and plasmids will reproduce themselves as long as you give them nutrients. And now what we're going to see are many copies of that plasmid, and many copies of, more importantly, that foreign DNA that we're interested in being produced, and now we can then go further with our experiments. So as you know, DNA is very small. So one of the things that we're going to have a problem with are small sample sizes of DNA. But how we handle that with biotechnology is by way of cloning that DNA. And we do so through a lab process called the polymerase chain reaction, or just for short, it's called PCR. So if you think about needing a copy of something, you take it to a copier and you hit the number and start and you get a bunch of copies of it. That's what this process is going to do for us when we have a very small sample of DNA. So basically, we're in an amplification process. We're going to amplify a targeted sequence of DNA. And it can basically create millions of copies of a single gene or a specific piece of DNA in nothing more than a test tube. And you can do this very quickly. So through a number of cycles of this PCR, we can go from, you know, just a minimal sample to millions upon millions of samples of just our targeted sequence of DNA we're interested in. There's going to be some requirements, though, for PCR to happen, so let's talk about those. First, we're going to need something called DNA polymerase. It's an enzyme, but we need a really special one because this DNA polymerase must be able to operate in very hot temperatures. So where better to go than from an organism that lives in a very hot environment? And there is a bacteria, it's an archaea bacteria called Thermus aquaticus, and for short we call it TAQ, T-A-Q, and it lives in hot springs that, you know, would be completely intolerable by most cells on the planet, but this one, life always finds a way, and it has to have these protein players, these enzymes working inside of it to exist. So that's where we're going to go ahead and get this DNA polymerase from. As you can see, it withstands the temperature necessary to separate double-stranded DNA. Because to separate a DNA strand, typically all we need is heat, and heat will cause the two sides of it to come apart. We're also going to need a supply of free nucleotides, because if we're building more DNA, I guess we got to have some spare parts. We got to have A's, T's, C's, and G's floating around in order to do so. And the last thing we're going to need here is primers. Now, a primer, as you can see here, are 10 to 20 base sequences which match the ends of the DNA sequence of interest. So these primers can be made and they can be bought. And they have certain sequences of letters of A's, T's, C's, and G's based their use on whatever we're looking, what gene of interest we're looking at. So we have sequenced a lot of genes and we know what letter sequences they are. So what we're going to need, because we usually do this on the ends of the sequence that we're interested in, the flanking ends of the DNA sequence, is we're going to look for those 10 to 20 base sequences in a row that match our gene of interest. So how does this whole PCR process work? Well, as you can see here, it's a three-step cycle. We're going to need to do some heating, some cooling, and some replication in order for that to happen. And essentially what we get is a chain reaction that produces an exponentially growing population of identical DNA molecules. So let's take a look at our little picture here. First, this is going to be the DNA double strand we're interested in. We want to make copies of it. So by heating it, we're going to separate these two blue strands, this double strand of DNA, and what we're able to do then is then build a new one to complement it. So we're next going to cool the thing down in order so we can attach those primers we talked about in the prior slide. And then we're going to heat it up just a little bit more so we can then have TAC polymerase go down and replicate it, as we can see in this new strand here on both sides, which is red. So we've now gone from one DNA copy to two. We're going to do that same thing again in the second cycle. We're going to heat it up. It's going to split this red one here, and this blue one's going there. This blue one's going here. This red one's going there. Splits it down the middle. And again, we're going to cool it down to attach our primer sequence. And we're going to do that now for all four of the strands. And we're going to heat it up just a little bit more to allow TAC polymerase to do its job and build new strands. So now we're up to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And we're going to keep on doing that. So we're going to start to grow exponentially. From 8, we're going to go to 16, 32, 64, 128, 256, 512, 1028. And I've just gone through a few numbers. I'm already over 1,000. So as we go longer and longer with this process, in a day, you can have millions and millions of copies of the DNA sequence that you're interested in. Okay, let's take a little closer look here. This blue represents our target sequence. This is the DNA that we're interested in. Remember, DNA runs anti-parallel to each other, so it goes 5 prime to 3 prime. So the first thing that's going to happen is we're going to hit it with some heat. And when we do that, we're going to denature that. So when we denature anything, it makes it come apart. And heat will do that to DNA. So we've now split a double-sided DNA molecule into two single-strand DNA molecules. And what we're going to do in step number two is we're going to cool this thing down. So this is a very hot step. We're going to cool it down here, and essentially that allows us to anneal our primers to the DNA. The word anneal means to attach, and in this case that's our primers to this single strand that's already there. So our primers are now attached, and now we're going to have the DNA polymerase molecule attach in the extension phase. And what's going to happen here is it's going to basically lodge on to the end of the primer, and it's going to move in this direction here, in this direction there to build new DNA, and in this direction here to build new DNA. And this is going to happen in a little bit of a warmer temperature, but this is our extension phase. So now we have two copies of our original target sequence, and we're going to keep going through cycles of PCR. So we go from 2 to 4, from 4 to 8. And this is going to continue on until we have enough that we can do whatever research we plan on doing with that gene sequence, or with that DNA sequence. So what do you do with DNA after you've made a whole bunch of it using PCR? Well, then you can analyze it when you're doing your research. And one of the ways we do that is by way of gel electrophoresis, the technique of using DNA fragment lengths called RFLPs to match or investigate DNA samples that we're looking at. Now, RFLP stands for this word that you see here, which, you know, I would say a lot of people would benefit from Googling a McGraw-Hill animation called Restriction Fragment Length Polymorphism. Whoa. Okay, so what we have is basically we're going to be cutting the DNA up in various sizes by way of restriction enzymes. We met those a little bit earlier. And then we can then plot them out so we can see the differences from one sample and another. Okay, so here we go. By treating DNA samples with our restriction enzymes, a unique collection of different length fragments is produced. Electrophoresing these fragments separate fragments according to two things, both charge and size. And it's usually used to measure the number of repeats of short sequences unique to every individual in their DNA. And it winds up producing a distinctive banding pattern that we can look at, kind of like a barcode. And if you look down here, you can see some barcode-y looking things down these lanes. And in this case here, it happens to be a paternity test with a mother and two children and the potential father there. So we'll revisit that in a little while to see how that works. So what exactly is this electrophoresis process? Well, first of all, let's just get into what it is on a basic level. It's a lab technique for separating mixtures of charged particles or molecules. So first of all, a mixture, we all know what mixtures are. They're materials composed of two or more elements or parts. So there we go. That looks like a pretty good mixture there. And a charged molecule is a molecule such as a protein or DNA that has too many or too few electrons. So this kind of goes back to the old chemistry days when we talk about electrons being equal, too many or too few can lead to negative charges or positive charges. For example, if I have a whole bunch of electrons all over me, those are negative charges, so I'm going to be negative. If somebody takes away my electrons, they take away my negativity, well, then I become more positive. So a charged molecule is based on the number of electrons that it has. Now let's kind of get a visual here of what separating charged molecules is like. Here we have our mixture, and as you can see, we can separate the charge into our positive and negative piles right here and here. Then we can go ahead and even separate these by size, which is what's going to happen through a gel when we electrophorese something. So we can separate, you know, here we have our big particles, down here we have our super tiny particles, and the others here are somewhere in between. And we can do that with both the positives and the negative ones. And then as a final part to our research, we can analyze whatever it is we're separating, identify those things, and then purify them if necessary as well. So what are essential parts of electrophoresis? Well, there's a bunch. Let's take a look at them. First, you got to have electrical current, because if you're dealing with things that are charged, you got to have an electrical current flowing in order to repel or attract certain types of substances based on their charge. We got to have a positive electrode. The positive electrode is going to be the thing that's going to be collecting the electrons. And our negative electrode is the wire that emits electrons. So essentially, electricity is a stream of electrons through a medium, and it goes from our negative electrode to our positive electrode, something like that. Now, we also have to have what's called a porous medium. A porous medium is some kind of substance that essentially this electricity can pass through, as well as our sample. And the key is that it contains pores. Pores are little tiny holes that can filter things based on size. So it has to be permeable to fluids and small particles. These holes have to be at a size range that allows the particles to get through, but allows some of them to get caught up along the way. So this porous medium essentially acts as a sieve, which is nothing more than a device to filter small particles out of a mixture of large particles. So how does this separation actually happen? Well, we mentioned earlier that electrical charge has a big part to do with it. And what we find is that biomolecules have charges associated with them. The sum of the charges that we find and the location of those charges will then give a little bit more information about the character of that molecule. For example, this one here has a positive charge on one end. So this end here is probably going to be attracted by negative poles, but repelled by positive poles. Over here on this end, I'm guessing this electronegative oxygen is more of a negative charge, and it will be attracted to a positive pole that it might wind up bumping into. Here we see a peptide, which is a string of amino acids that has 1, 2, 3, 4 positive charges and just a couple of negative charges. So this will probably be attracted to a negatively charged pole as well. This one here is kind of crazy. There's a lot going on there, but if you counted up all of the minuses compared to the pluses, you're going to find abundance of minuses, which means it's a negatively charged particle, and it's probably going to result in the movement towards a positive pole. So what we can say then is negatively charged molecules are attracted to positive electrodes, and positively charged molecules are attracted to negative electrodes. And that's how we're going to start to see the separation begin. So if the first part of separation is based on charge, the second part then is based on size. And we talked about the importance of there being a porous material like we see here. There's tons of holes in this thing just about everywhere. And big clunky stuff isn't going to be able to get through all the little tiny holes where small speedy molecules can. So what we see then, if we have a whole bunch of proteins entering here and they got to work their way to the bottom, the big stuff isn't going to make it through very far. It's going to all get caught up at the top. The medium-sized stuff's going to get stuck somewhere along the way. And the little tiny, smallest, fast-moving particles, they're going to go the furthest in that particular porous material. There used to be a video game in the 80s called Centipede, and your centipede that you're trying to destroy, you're at the bottom of the screen. The centipede is really long and it's at the top. And as you start busting up the centipede into smaller and smaller pieces, these little pieces started speeding down, and they became harder and harder to catch because they were moving so quickly on their own without having the rest of the centipede behind it. So I like to think of the movement through one of these porous materials kind of like centipede. Okay, let's take a look at one of these gel electrophoresis units. What we see here, first of all, let's kind of explain what we have. This is an electrical box, and we see the cathode here, and we see the anode there. So essentially what we have is we have electrons that are going to leave the cathode, and once this thing is turned on, they're going to go this way towards the anode, or the positive end of this particular electrical box. We can also see that there is what's called an agarose gel laid in the box, which has some depressions in it, which we call wells. So these here are wells, and their purpose is to collect the DNA. Well, you actually inject the DNA into the wells, or a machine does it. And right here are our DNA samples. So let's imagine that we took a tiny little fragment of DNA, we did PCR to it, and now we have a big enough sample that we can inject it into these wells, turn on the power of this electrophoresis unit, and then what we see is because this end here is negative and this end here is positive, we're going to see certain things happen. So after a short time, if you look down below here, we can see that the DNA has moved from these wells in bands as we go from left to right down the gel. And you can see they're horizontal bands in the lane, and their movement is based on size and electrical charge as well, like we said. So longer molecules are going to wind up getting caught somewhere at the top of the gel near the wells. Medium length ones are somewhere in the middle, and the smallest, the short molecules wind up, the little speedy ones, down here at the end of the gel when the power shut off. Then what you can do is you can visually analyze this gel and see, do the bands match from one lane to the next? If these are three different samples of DNA, 1, 2, 3, and part of your research is determining if they match, well, you're going to have a nice banding pattern here to compare one versus another in order to come up with your answer. Okay, I got a homework assignment for you. I want you to do a virtual DNA fingerprinting exercise, and you can find it at Nova. We all love Nova. And there, if you Google Nova and create a DNA fingerprint, it's going to take you to a nice exercise where you can go through all the steps of doing one of these DNA fingerprints. As you can see, there's no fingers involved here, but instead, it's the DNA that we're looking at, and we're comparing it with other DNA. So go there, check it out, and have some fun. Let's say we were looking at two samples of DNA, and we were concerned that one of the samples contained the DNA sequence that coded for sickle cell anemia. So one of the things that we're going to do is we're going to hit our DNA samples with a restriction enzyme called DDE1. We'll call it DDE1. And DDE1 is going to find certain sequences of A's, T's, C's, and G's, and it's going to make cuts wherever it finds one. So as you can see in this particular stretch of DNA here, for a normal beta globin allele, it makes 1, 2, 3, and 4 cuts in this stretch of DNA. Now, our second sample is changed in DNA. Because we learned in our genetics unit that sickle cell anemia results from a point mutation, which changes essentially a letter in the DNA, which then is going to code for a different amino acid. What's going to happen on a DNA level is DDE1, our restriction enzyme, isn't going to make 4 cuts in this one. Because we have a different letter sequence, this one here is only going to make 3 cuts, as we can see there. Okay, or essentially I could say, yeah, well, it makes 3 cuts. So if we then compare by way of gel electrophoresis, the normal globin allele versus the sickle cell mutant beta globin allele, what we're going to see is some key differences in the gel that results from it. For example, we're going to find some large fragments in both of them. In both of them, we're both going to have this identical fragment here, from this cut to this cut. It's the same length, and that's why we have this band here and this band here that are equal. Now, down in this end here, because we were able to make a couple of cuts in this one and just the one cut here, notice that this stretch here is 376 BP. That means base pairs. So what we have is we now have a line that's going to exist in the sickle cell allele at 376. But that same segment that goes from essentially here to here, on our normal one, gets split down somewhere near the center, which produces a 175 base pair fragment, and a 201, which is here and here. So comparing them side by side, you can definitely see that this sample in this DNA here codes for not the normal allele with its typical bands at these three locations, but instead this band here, which matches, and this 376 base pair band, which is going to be typical for the allele of sickle cell anemia. Another benefit to gel electrophoresis, DNA fingerprinting, is paternity testing. So we can find out who is the potential father of a child in question here. So we have our mothers, we have four people on these bands of this gel, the mother, the child, and two potential males who could be the father. And the mother's bands, as you can see, they have this purple tone to them. And we can see that there's a lot of connections with the mother and the child at various locations. Now, the red bands are going to signify the paternal DNA. So for that, we can see that if we compare male 1 and male 2 with this offspring, we find a lot of matching bands here with male number 1 and not so many with male number 2, just a few. So in this case here, the evidence is leading towards male 1 being the potential father of this child. I want to mention another thing that is looked at when we look try to identify two samples of DNA, and that's the idea of STRs, what's also known as short tandem repeats. So one of the things that we're able to do is look at these regions of short tandem repeats and compare them with a known sample of genetic material. Now, a short tandem repeat is something where you have a same letter combination seen a whole bunch of times in a row. For example, if you take a look at down here, maybe GATCT is repeated at this location on chromosome 2 5 times in one individual. But in another individual, it's repeated 20 times in a row. It doesn't really code for any particular protein that we know of. It's just the same four letters again and again and again. 5 times in one person, 20 times in the other person. And as you notice here in yellow, we have a whole bunch of different sites. This is 13 of them. And this is actually the 13 sites the FBI will use when they're trying to compare one sample with another one. As you can read down below, the possibility of two individuals coding for the same in STRs for 13 loci is greater than 1 in a billion. So if you have a sample that matches these same 13 sites with the same number of short tandem repeats, you pretty much have it right on the money that is a complete match. When you're talking about the 1 in a billion of it being someone else, that's a pretty good set of odds, being that we only have 7 billion people on the planet. Let's now mention the types of products that biotechnology can produce for us. Now, the first one is one that makes a lot of headlines. It's genetically engineered organisms. They are called technically genetically modified organisms, or you've probably heard these three letters before, GMOs. Now, if you have an organism, either plant or animal, that has a foreign gene inserted in that, we consider it transgenic. And there's a good chance that any of this produce that you see here that you buy at the market, it has been tinkered with genetically. And typically it does it so it has better traits for the consumer. Same thing with the animal over here. We mess around with the DNA a little bit in the laboratory. We change it to produce some kind of outcome that we want. We enucleate an egg cell, inserting the DNA that we created into that egg cell. And hopefully by implanting a bunch of them in this cow, we'd be able to produce an offspring that now has the desired traits that DNA coded for. Going back to the bacteria for a minute, like we saw in the earlier slide, bacteria is often transgenic as well when humans interact with it and try to use it to create products that make our lives better. So we insert these genes into the bacteria. The bacteria will then be grown in large vats called bioreactors, and the product is then harvested. There is stuff on the market today that has been created in this way. For example, insulin. For diabetics, insulin, having a ready supply of it is very, very important to keep their blood sugar levels in check. The hepatitis B vaccine, TPA, which we mentioned earlier, that dissolves clots related to heart attacks, and human growth hormone. All of these things are created by transgenic bacteria because scientists have inserted genes in them to produce these products that we need. other modifications that are out there. Some of them have to do with plants. Some of them have to do with, you know, human disasters, human-made disasters. For example, frost-resistant produce. If we can find a gene that allows plants to not be so susceptible to early frost, which could then kill them, we've made them stronger and more tolerable to environmental conditions. We can also have crops that contain an insect toxin. We mentioned those earlier. So if a plant is getting decimated by a certain type of insect, either natural or invasive, we now have the genetics that can go to battle that insect onslaught. Also the oil-eating bacteria we talked about, when humans, you know, create a disaster like an oil spill, I think it's only fair that we've created a fix to that problem. And in this way, it's basically genetically modifying the bacteria to clean up the mess that we made. Zeroing in on transgenic plants just for a moment, we mentioned earlier that there were some toxins that we could basically insert a gene into a plant. It would create the toxin, and then it wouldn't be susceptible to insect attacks. So we've done that. We've done it for cotton, corn, potato strains, all have this already. Soybeans are now resistant to a common herbicide, and weed killer resisting crops are also now common. We call those Roundup Ready plants, which means that the weed killer that you can buy at, you know, at the hardware store called Roundup, if you spray it on these plants, they won't die from it. So they are resistant to Roundup, where everything else is supposed to die. Human hormone production can actually exist in plants as well. So we can basically gear up plants genetically to produce hormones, clotting factors for certain patients, antibodies can be produced in their seeds. So let's just take a look at this picture here for a second. Here we have a bacterium. And we are extracting and isolating the DNA from it. We will clone and design these genes, which can then be transformed. They can transform a plant cell to now carry that gene. We culture that particular cell so it produces more of itself. The plants will then carry this gene and thus produce this trait that we're after, and then if we allow the plant to reproduce a number of times, we now have a huge assortment of plants that are producing something that we need, and that's a transgenic plant. We can also insert genes into animals, which we would say then makes it a transgenic animal. And we can do this by basically a set of tools like a vortex mixer. And in this tube as well, there's tiny little needles that will poke holes into animal eggs and cells and allow for foreign DNA that's floating around in this liquid here to then be taken up by those eggs and those cells. For example, here, bovine growth hormone, BGH. That's one of the things that we can have produced by inserting a gene into, in this case here, would be a cow's egg. What would you do with this? Well, you could make your animals be larger, more muscular. You know, if these animals are being bred for food, obviously if you're raising this animal, you want the best product possible, the ones with the most meat, the most muscle, the ones that are able to essentially get to that muscular state the fastest on the least amount of food. So there's a lot of tinkering that goes on there. But sometimes the product is so unnatural looking that, basically those plants can be thrown on the scrap heap, or maybe not. So, you know, as we go from 7 billion to 8 billion people, one of the things that we have to look at realistically is there enough food to sustain 7 to 8 million people, or possibly 9 million people in the next decade or so? And the answer might be tinkering with genetics in order to produce larger food items for people. For example, one of the things, a certain type of growth hormone can be inserted into this fish right here, but you can see the outcome. It's kind of a Frankenfish looking thing. However, there's a lot more muscle, nearly double the muscle on this fish than you'd find in one without. So if we look at a couple more here, this scientist is holding, notice the difference in the one here on the left versus the one on the right. You basically have this you know, fish right here has like abs coming out of it. There's so much musculature associated with this one, and that produces more meat for consumers. So it's something realistically people are going to have to start looking at as our food supplies dwindle down with increasing population. Another thing that we can do with animals is what's called gene farming, and that's using these transgenic animals to produce pharmaceuticals. So let's say we wanted a goat to produce human growth hormone. What we're going to do is we're going to find the gene for human growth hormone, and we're going to insert it into the egg by way of like vortex mixing, so it becomes part of the genome of the goat. After that, we're going to basically then allow that what is now a complete egg cell with a new gene to develop in a host goat. And next, what we're going to find is that the goat that is produced now has the ability to produce milk that has human growth hormone inside of it. Now, because we made the genome of this goat accept a new gene, it's now going to be in every cell of this goat. So what we can then do is we can go ahead and we can take out any cell from the goat and enucleate some eggs, and what's going to happen then is we'll then take the entire cell, insert it, the nuclear contents, into the egg cell, and then do our implantation thing again and allow new goats, a whole new group of goats to basically be born that also have the ability to produce milk with human growth hormone inside of it. So essentially, we're now tinkering with the genetics of animals, of livestock, to also produce things that we need. Are there any other possibilities besides human growth hormone? Of course, there's a lot. So we have plans right now to produce drugs that treat cystic fibrosis, cancer, blood diseases, etc. So we're using livestock to help better human health, as well as, you know, hopefully and sustainably producing food that will help us, you know, through tough times to come as population increases. Part of biotechnology also deals with human disease, so the ability to treat disorders can be a very important aspect of biotechnology as well. For example, gene therapy is used to give patients healthy genes to make up for a faulty gene. It also includes the use of genes to treat genetic disorders and various human illnesses. Now, there's two ways to treat it. One is ex vivo, which means outside the body, and another way is called in vivo, which we'll get to in a second. But with ex vivo, what we're going to do is we're going to pull out, for example, bone marrow stem cells from kids who have SCID, or severe combined immunodeficiency. We're going to infect them with a virus. And as you know, viruses can be effective vectors for delivering genes. So we'll infect them with a virus, and then we'll return them to the body. So now they produce new cells that have this gene that was infected into them to now produce whatever it is that we're after. Another thing we may do by way of in vivo treatment, which means inside the body, is try to get genes of a known sequence inside of a patient to help them as well. For example, patients with cystic fibrosis have faulty ion channels inside of their lung tissue. So one of the things that we're trying to do is create a treatment by way of gene therapy that uses a nasal or respiratory spray to get those genes inside and hopefully do the patient some good. This diagram depicts the delivery system of some of these therapeutic transgenes. So as you can see here, one of the things that can happen is it can be packaged into a delivery vehicle such as a virus. So this virus particle is carrying the new gene that we're after, and it's going to be injected directly into the patient. That would be direct delivery. There's also cell-based delivery here, where we have some cells that have been taken from the patient, such as stem cells, and outside the body, they're then grown in a dish. They're being infected by a virus. They'll continue to grow as a new mass or number of masses of cells and be readministered to the patient. That would be more of what we call a cell-based delivery system. The last part of this talk deals with genomics, and there's no better example here to talk about than the Human Genome Project. First of all, genomics is the study of genomes of both humans and other organisms that are out there. Your genome consists of all the genetic information of you, basically, of an individual or the species. So you could have genome of the Homo sapiens, which means that you're going to have a number of randomly selected people that you take that information from, or your particular genome is your set of genes that make you you. So the Human Genome Project started as something that was very labor intensive. And over the years, as the technology got better and things got automated, it started to speed up. But the goal was to determine the base pair sequence of Homo sapiens, of a human being. They had already done flies, they'd already done mice and all kinds of smaller animals, but it was time to do the human genome. They also wanted to construct a map showing the specific sequence of genes on the specific chromosome. So basically, it's a working draft that they're working on. It wound up getting finished in the year 2000. It took about 13 years to sequence 3 billion base pairs along the length of our 23 pairs of chromosomes. So what was found with the Human Genome Project? Well, first of all, the number of genes. We have between 20 and 25,000 genes. That number is still being worked on today because some of them are regulatory and they code for RNA as well. But most of the genes that we have do code for proteins, but most of the DNA, however, does not. And remember, it's a difference between genes and DNA. Most of the DNA does not code for proteins. It's only every so often you're going to find a gene amongst those 3 billion base pairs. In the past, they used to describe the DNA that didn't code for protein as junk, but we found out that junk wasn't really a great term for it. Junk didn't specify the order of amino acids in a polypeptide. But what we found also was the fact that between 74 and 93% of the genome is transcribed into RNA and not protein. So what we say is that it has a regulatory function that may not be exactly a protein that's building, but maybe it's like a volume dial on how much or when that particular protein should be expressed. So we have some controls that are built into the DNA that don't code for a protein, but they code for expression of those protein-based genes. This is a super hot research area. There will be a lot of jobs in the future in the biotechnology industry by determining what genes code for what and the regulatory sequences, how they affect those genes' expression. But calling genes junk, calling DNA junk, we're quickly turning that around and deciding that DNA does not have a whole lot of junk involved with it. Instead, we're still trying to figure out what all the extra non-protein coding sequences actually code for. As far as gene structures are concerned, genes were defined as discrete units of heredity that corresponded to a locus on a chromosome. Prokaryotes are bacteria. They typically possess a singular circular chromosome without any introns and have less DNA. So anything that you're going to find on this DNA here is going to be expressed. Eukaryotic chromosomes, on the other hand, have much more DNA, more complex. They have much more, I guess, sequences and regions than a bacterial one. They have introns, exons, intergenic sequences. So what is all that stuff? Well, basically, introns were regions, as we can see down here, that were spliced out when it was time to translate one of these DNA sequences. Exons were expressed. So essentially, through a number of steps that you see here, DNA to RNA will then turn into a mature RNA after a little bit of processing and eventually become a protein. But notice how long this segment was. And as it goes further in the process, it gets scaled down. And now it's just your exons that are going to be expressed into these amino acids down here. In addition to the exons and introns, we mentioned that there were what's called intergenic sequences. So in the long distances that sometimes exist between genes, we can find these intergenic sequences. And sometimes they have what's called repetitive DNA elements. So earlier in our talk, we talked about STRs, short tandem repeats that different individuals of the same species will have different numbers of them. Some have 5, some have 20, some have 1,000. We also call those STRs satellites, which we can look for then in some types of testing that we do. We also know there's the ability for genes to jump around on DNA, and transposons cover that. They're specific DNA sequences that have the ability to move between chromosomes. So they're also known as jumping genes. And Barbara McClintock was the scientist who has the most research credited to her in the study of these transposons. Proteomics is the study of structure, function, and interaction of cellular proteins. 20 to 25,000 of our genes, like we said earlier, are translated into proteins. And the sum total of all those is going to be called our proteome. So understanding protein function is key to the development of better drugs. Now, how does it do that? Well, if we can correlate a particular drug treatment to a particular genome, what we can see is that that particular medicine is tailored specifically for that patient. It increases efficiency and decreases potential side effects of that medication because it's geared towards that one individual. So once the primary structure of a protein is known, we should be able to predict their tertiary structure. Computer modeling of the tertiary of the structure of these proteins is an important part of proteomics. So we look at all parts of the protein and we determine, is this a good match? Would this work for that patient and for what specific set of reasons? Let's finish off with the current understanding of what a gene actually is. So we have it defined here, a genomic sequence, either DNA or RNA, that directly encodes functional products, which can be either RNA or protein. So as we can see down here, some of our DNA can be unwound, and then we find genes which code for proteins. But we also have the ability for these segments of DNA to code for RNA products. And we can see here tRNA, mRNA, and rRNA are three types of RNA, which have direct connections to how DNA gets expressed. So I know that's a lot today. And like I said, with biotechnology, it's such a huge field. We're only able to scratch the surface. But I do hope that you learned a lot. Keep studying. I'll talk to you guys next time. See ya.